Well, good morning, folks. We are Donna and Donna, and we're very, very pleased to be here. We want to say thank you so much for letting us come and worship with you this morning. And thank you for no snow. We appreciate that. Well, for the next 40 to 45 minutes, we're going to be hammering on some strings, sing you some songs, and we'll be telling you some stories in between. And we're going to start it out with a song that has been around for a long, long time. It's called Unclouded Day.
Tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day.
Oh, the land of cloudless day. Oh, the land of an unclouded sky.
Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise.
Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day.
They tell me of a king and his beauty there, and they tell me that my eyes shall behold where he sits upon a throne that is whiter than stone, in a city that is made of gold.
Oh, the land of cloudless day. Oh, the land of an unclouded sky.
Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise.
Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day.
Oh,
the land of cloudless day. Oh, the land of an unclouded sky.
They tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise.
Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day.
It is so good to be here in Minnesota. We actually lived in Minnesota for a short time, back about 1978, I think. We lived in International Falls for 2 months. We moved there from Iowa in May, and the ice was still on the river. It still is. As we travel like this each weekend, a lot of times folks like to know what we do for a living. We just do this on the weekends, about 48 or 49 weekends out of the year. We pack everything up at the end of the week and head to different parts of the country. We'll be back in Tennessee next weekend, and the next weekend we'll be back here in Minnesota, and we get to stay a couple of weeks. We're going to be in the Detroit Lakes area on Sabbath, and then we get to go to camp meeting, and we're looking forward to that. Well, Don works with wood. He builds cabinets and furniture and things like that. And for a little over 20 years now, he's been building these musical instruments full time. Folks were often asking where they could get these old-fashioned Bible instruments. So he started out building a psaltery. You know how the Bible talks about the psaltery and the harp? Well, that little triangle-shaped one that I played with a bow is a psaltery. So he started building those. And then he started building mountain dulcimer like I'll play on my lap. He builds these hammer dulcimers. And he started building zithers a while back, too. After a while, we'll hold them up so you can get a better look at them. My part is to help put the strings on. And I'm a nurse. I actually retired from being a nurse practitioner about 2 years ago. So now we don't have to go back home every week for me to go back to work. So that's been a blessing. Well, a few years ago, we were heading out west to Arizona, and we were driving on I-40, somewhere between Grants and Gallup, New Mexico. And I looked up in the sky, and there was a sun dog. Have you ever seen that? little rainbow that's by the sun sometimes. And it reminded me when I was growing up on the farm there in Northeast Iowa, we used to see sun dogs, and I asked my dad what that meant, because he knows a lot about nature. And he said, well, if the sun dog is on the north, it's going to get colder. And if the sun dog is on the south, it's going to get warmer. Well, one day I saw a double sun dog. There was one on both sides. So I said, well, Dad, what does that mean? And he said, well, that means it's either going to get warmer or it's going to get colder. Well, what does it take to make a rainbow? Two things. Water and light. And the way the light goes through the little moisture droplets, it spreads out the spectrum and we see the beautiful colors. Excuse me. And that reminds me of a scripture. In Psalm 85:10, it says, mercy and truth are met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. It takes both, doesn't it? Mercy and truth, like two sides of the same coin, righteousness and peace, law and grace. And they all come together at the cross, where Jesus willingly laid down his life for our sins, because he loves us so much. Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified, knowing not it was for me he died on Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdens all found liberty at Calvary. By God's word at last my sin I learned, then I trembled at the law I'd spurned, till my guilty soul imploring turned to Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. See, there was great and grace was free, pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdens all found liberty at Calvary, at Calvary, at Calvary.
Donna and I live in West Tennessee, but before that, we lived outside of a little town called Fair Grove. Now, Fair Grove is about 15 miles north of Springfield, Missouri. And at that time, the Lord had blessed us with about 6 acres of land, and I would say probably 90% of the land was trees, so we had a lot of wildlife there. We had the turkey and the deer, the rabbits, the squirrels, and we had a lot of birds. And we moved there. Donna said, I'd like to have a bird feeder right outside of our living room window. So we went out shopping for a bird feeder. Now, we got one of those squirrel-proof bird feeders. don't you believe it. Those squirrels can get into just about anything they want to. But that's not the story. We got one of those feeders. We hung it outside. We filled it up full of bird seed, and sure enough, the birds started coming in. We had the cardinals, the finches, the redwood woodpeckers would come in. The little chickadees will fly in. Then the doves will come in and pick up the seeds that fall on the ground. So we had a good variety of birds that would come in. And they'd come flying in about 7:30 in the morning to get their breakfast. They would fly in there, grab their food, and fly off. And one morning I was sitting there watching them, and they were flying in and flying out, and this little chickadee flew in there, landed, but it didn't fly away. And I would watch it, and every once in a while it'd flap its wings, but it still wouldn't fly. So I went right up to the window. Now the bird feeder was about 4 feet from the window. I went up to the window, I watched that bird for a while. He'd flap its wings, he'd jump a little bit, but he still wouldn't fly away. So I got my shoes on and I walked out on the deck, went right up to that bird feeder, and here that little chickadee had got its head stuck right between the two bars where the seeds come out. Folks, he could have flapped his wings all day. He wasn't going anywhere. So I grabbed a hold of him with my right hand, and with my left hand, I opened up the back of that bird feeder, and I wiggled his little head out between those two bars. I made sure he was okay, and when I opened up my hand, he flew and landed about 3 feet from me on our railing, and he turned around and looked at me. No, he didn't talk to me. But if he could have, he probably would have said, thank you. Thank you for getting me out of the situation I got myself into. You know, kindness works on everything. Everybody needs to try a little kindness. If you see your brother standing by the road with a heavy load from the seeds he sowed, if you see your sister falling by the way, just stop and say, you're going the wrong way. You got to try a little kindness, show a little kindness, shine your light for everyone to see. And if you try a little kindness, then you overlook the blindness of a narrow-minded people on a narrow-minded a helping hand instead of a dime. And the kindness that you show every day will help someone along life's way. You got to try a little kindness, show a little kindness, shine your light for everyone to see. And try a little kindness, then you overlook the blindness of the narrow-minded people on a narrow-minded
My dad had 8 brothers and sisters, and one of his brothers, his older brother Tom, is someone that a lot of people from Minnesota knew, Tom Hind. He used to teach at Maplewood Academy, and he loved what he did. He loved working with the young people. We used to go visit him. He loved trains, too. He had all these trains in the basement that you could go and watch it go all over the place. But somewhere in his early 40s, Uncle Tom began to notice that his legs were getting weak, especially at the end of the day. And it didn't seem to get better, so he went to the doctor, and he was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis. And within a very short time, he became a total quadriplegic, couldn't use his arms or his legs, and so he couldn't teach anymore, and that broke his heart. But one day he was watching TV, and they had this program on the public channel where they were teaching people with handicaps how to paint. And so Uncle Tom thought, maybe I can learn how to do that. And so he began to paint beautiful pictures with a paintbrush in his mouth. And as the disease progressed, it got so bad he couldn't even move his neck. So his precious wife, Bev, would move the canvas and put paint on the brush so he could paint. And I brought in a little album with several of his paintings, and it looks like it's already been going around. And he used to paint for a company called Courage Cards. And he would paint Christmas cards and things. And some of what you see in that little album are some of the cards that he painted. And I remember thinking so much of my Uncle Tom. Grandma and Grandpa had 9 kids, and we had over 40 cousins. And we would have family reunions. And Uncle Tom, when he and his family came, when it was time for the annual softball game, I wasn't the last one picked. Uncle Tom would pick me. And I couldn't run very fast or play very well, but it made me feel special. I remember he would put ice down my sister's back. I could never get away with that. And then this had to happen to him, and it was heartbreaking. But you know, in all of my life, I never heard my uncle speak one sad or negative word. Every word was praise to the Lord. He'd say things like this: if I had never had MS, I wouldn't even know that I could paint. I think in all of his years of college, I don't think he ever took any art classes. We don't live in a world where things are fair, do we? Bad things happen to good people. There is an enemy here. And we don't have a world of peace like we wish for. Another artist was asked to paint a picture of peace. What would you paint? Maybe a beautiful Minnesota sunset, or maybe a lake scene. Well, this artist painted a picture of a raging thunderstorm. And in the midst of the storm on a little twig was a bird singing her heart out for joy in the midst of the storm. I think that's perfect peace, don't you? That's the peace I saw in my uncle's face. Jesus said, "My peace I give you, not like the world gives, but my peace. Let not your hearts be troubled." Well, I'm tired and so weary, but I must go along. Till the Lord comes and calls me away, oh yes. And the morning so bright, and the Lamb is the light, and the night is as dark as a sea, oh yes.
There will be peace in the valley for me. Be peace in the valley for me, dear Lord, I pray. There'll be no sadness, no sorrow, no trouble I see. There will be peace in the valley for me.
Gentle, and the bear will be tame, and the lion shall lay down with the lamb, oh yes. And the beast from the wild will be led by a child, and I'll be changed from this creature that I am.
There will be peace in the valley for me someday. There will be peace in the valley for me, dear Lord, I pray. There'll be no sadness, no sorrow, no trouble I see. There will be peace in the valley for me.
sing along if you'd like to.
There will be peace in the valley for me someday. There will be peace in the valley for me, dear Lord, I pray. There'll be no sadness, no sorrow, no trouble I see. There will be peace in the valley for me.
There will be peace in the valley for me.
Hey, before we go on to the next song, how many of you folks would like to know what the instruments are? Thank you. I wouldn't know what to say if you said no, so I'm glad you do. I'll tell you what we're going to do. We're going to raise up the ones we can because we know that you know what some of these are. And when we raise them up, you tell us what they are, okay? How about this one right here? A mountain dulcimer. Very good. That's also called a lap dulcimer because you play it on your lap. And the difference between the mountain dulcimer and the lap dulcimer is when you're in the mountains, it's a mountain dulcimer. Very good. Yeah, and when you're on the flatlands, it's a lap dulcimer. That's the only difference between the two. How about this one here? No? A mandolin. Very good. That is a custom-made mandolin. Donna's brother is building mandolins, and he built that one for us, and we're glad he did because we really enjoy playing it. He also builds guitars, and we didn't bring his guitar with us because, well, we hang that on the wall so it doesn't get scratched up and beat up. How about this one here? Psaltery, that is a bowed psaltery, just like they talk about it in the book of Psalms. They talk about a psaltery and a harp and some of the other instruments that King David played. That is the psaltery. Everywhere we go, we tell everybody that that's the psaltery that David played. Of course, we're talking about our son, David, is who we're talking about. How about this one here? It starts with a Z. A zither, yes, that is called a zither. They started making a zither back in the late 1800s, and all you do in a zither is you pluck the notes. Early 1900s, they came out with an auto harp, and some of you may know what an auto harp is. And actually, the auto harp took the place of the zither because they made it a lot easier for folks to play. On the auto harp, you push the notes down, then you strum the strings. On the zither, you have to pluck each note out. How about the one right up front she was hammering on? Hammer dulcimer, very good. Well, we're going to go ahead and do a song called Lily of the Valley, and Donna's going to start it with a zither, go to the psaltery, and then go into the hammer dulcimer. Now, folks, if she gets a little excited, one comes flying your way. You catch it, all right? Because we don't want it to fall and break on the floor. We was out in Arizona here not too long ago, and it was a long church, and there was a gentleman sitting way in the back, and he hollered out, "If we catch it, can we keep it?" No. You have to give it back so we can finish the program. Now, Donna's been pretty good. There's nothing been flying. This is Lily of the Valley. Thank you.
Don and I really enjoy praising the Lord with these instruments. And when we come in, we got to come in a little, about an hour or so early, so we can tune these strings. We have 168 strings that we need to tune up. So it takes a little bit of time to do that. But you know, in Psalms 33:2, it does say, praise the Lord with the instrument of 10 strings. We have that covered. We figure if 10 is good, many ought to be fantastic. We're going to go ahead and do one of our most favorite songs to do, and Donna will start it with a zither, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. One of the things Donna and I really enjoy doing, and that is going to the schools and showing the children the instruments and playing the instruments for them and then tell them a little bit about the instruments. And about 5 years ago, we were out in California, and we had about 15 concerts out there, and one of the Christian schools found out that we were there and said, would you come over to the school? And we said, we'd love to do that. And the teacher had about he was a music teacher, and he had about, grades 1 through 8. And every hour he'd have them come in a class at a time. He'd have a different class. And he'd stand them outside the door and he would tell them, I have a special treat for you today. And then he'd let them come in and we'd be playing the instruments and they'd come in real quiet. They'd sit down. We'd play a little bit for them and then we'd tell them about the instruments and play a little more. And then we'd let them come up and play them, and they really enjoyed that part. And it was the fourth grader's turn. And he stood them outside the door and he told them, I have a special treat for you today. And one of the little fourth grader boys raised his hand and said, is it muffins? And he said, well, you'll find out when you get in there. So he let them come in, and they were very quiet. And they come in and we were playing the instruments. They sat down. We told them about the instruments, played a little more, and then we let them play. And it was their turn to leave. And as they were leaving, the little fourth grader boy went up to his teacher and said, this was better than muffins. So that was the day we found out that we were better than muffins. But we did a song for them called Shall We Gather at the River, and Donna will show you what it sounded like. Thank you. two more songs to do for you. We want to say thank you so much for letting us come and worship with you. We do hope at least one of the songs so far has touched you and blessed you in some way. We would like to mention, if you like this type of music, you can go on our website now and order right off the website. And the website is folkmountaingospel.com. And again, thank you so much. And we have two songs to do for you.
A few years ago, our older son Daniel was recommitting his heart to the Lord. When he got into academy, he started making bad choices, and he'd walked away from the Lord, and it just made us rejoice to see him coming back. And he was reading Fox's Book of Martyrs. Not such an easy thing to read. And The Great Controversy. And as he was studying the lives of these great men and women of God who stood up and gave testimony to their faith, even at the risk of their own lives, something puzzled him. How did these great men and women of God know the words to say that would ring through the centuries? How did Martin Luther know to say as he stood before the Diet, "It is unsafe for a man to speak against his conscience. Here I stand. I can do no other." Well, Daniel pondered that for a while, and then he found that verse in the book of Matthew that says, "Don't plan ahead of time what you're going to say when you're called to give testimony to your faith. The Holy Spirit will give you the words at that time." And Daniel wrote this song, and when he sang it for us, it touched our hearts. Sisters and brothers, we know, as we look around the world that we live in today, that the things that Jesus said would happen just before he comes back are happening all around us. And not just in the financial world or the political world or the natural world, but even in our own churches. And Jesus said, when you begin to see these things come to pass, look up and lift up your heads. Your redemption draweth nigh. But between now and the time when Jesus comes back, things will not be easy for those who love him. And the time will come, maybe even has come, when each one of us will be called to give testimony to our faith. Maybe not in the words that we say, but in the lives that we live. And the only way we're going to be able to stand up and be counted for Jesus is if we surrender our hearts to him moment by moment, spend time studying his word and in prayer, sharing his love with others. And if he brings something to our attention that we're holding on to that's separating us from him, we're saying, "Oh, Father, I surrender all. I don't want there to be anything between me and you, so that we may stand, come what may." Teach me, Lord, today. Tell me what to say. I will be a light.
I will be a light.
Shining in the night. Though the world takes me to flames, I will keep the fight. I have heard the stories told about the faithful men of old. They were faithful to the fire. To be like them is my desire. Help me stand for you, I pray. Help me witness, come what may. There will come a time when our light must shine. Men will hate us for our ways. That is why we must today learn to keep the faith.
Learn to keep the faith.
All the things we say, all the things we do and think, that way we can stand without a blame. I have heard the stories told about the faithful men of old. They were faithful to shine for Jesus' sake. It's all worth it just to call him friend over again. I have heard the stories told by the faithful men of old. They were faithful to the fire. To be like them is my desire. Help me stand for you, I pray. Help me witness, come what may.
Come what may.
Help me stand.
Come what may.
Stand for him. Well, I mentioned that I'm a nurse, and I was a nurse for over 30 years. I worked in lots of areas of nursing practice. I worked in the intensive care units and pediatrics. I taught nursing for about 20 years. And when I was teaching, most of the time, I was working in maternal child nursing. So I would take students to labor and delivery and postpartum and newborn nursery and also the intensive care nursery. So my specialty is maternal child. But as we were getting ready to retire, we were living in southern Missouri, and our granddaughter lives in Nashville, Tennessee. So we decided we wanted to be closer to Nashville, so we bought some land over there in West Tennessee. And when we first moved there, there was nothing on the land, so we lived in our camper for about a year and a half. We were glad that we weren't in Minnesota. But we got our house built, and I was still commuting back and forth to Springfield, Missouri for my job. And I had only 4 more years to go until retirement, and so I thought, well, I'll just keep commuting. It was a 6.5-hour commute, and it got old fast. So the little hospital there in our county, Decatur County, they had a little 5- or 6-bed hospital, and they needed a nurse practitioner. And things weren't always busy in the clinic, and so sometimes after I was hired, they asked if I would work over at the emergency department. We're not too far from I-40, so we would often get accidents and things in the ER. Well, one day I was helping in the ER, and the ambulance call came in. We are out at a house way out in the woods, and we're picking up a young girl. She is probably maybe 15 or 16, and she just delivered her baby in the bathtub. And he is way too early, and he is not doing well. And she was the only one home. And so I got together what little equipment that we had and waited for the ambulance to arrive. And the first thing I did, or that we as a staff did, we called Jackson, the big hospital about 1.5 hours away, and said, please get the helicopter in the air. We have a sick baby coming. And so the ambulance arrived and the baby came to me. And he was blue and limp. And I did what you do. I gave him oxygen and I warmed him up and stimulated his little muscles and prayed, Father, please save this little boy. And all of a sudden, he turned pink from head to toe. And his little muscles got strong and he let out a big yell, and I knew he was going to be okay. So things began to calm down, and I had opportunity to look over at his young mama. And she was so young, and she looked so scared. And the nurse practitioner taking care of her was being just as rude as she could be, screaming into this young face, you selfish thing, how could you do this? It's all about the baby. What drugs are you on? And my heart went out to her. And I thought, there, but for the grace of God, go I. How do I know that if my life had been just like her life, that might have been me laying there wondering if my little son would survive? What kind of life must she have had? How much is one soul worth? The only way to estimate the worth of one soul is to look at the price that Jesus was willing to pay for one. He would have left heaven and come to this little dark earth if only one of us would have needed his saving grace. He loves us that much. And when Jesus looks at us, he doesn't primarily see our sin. He sees what we can become by His grace, how much is one soul worth? Well, someone wrote a poem about the worth of a soul, and this author compared it to an old violin that came up for auction. And to the people at the auction, it looked worthless. Until the master violinist came forward, and tuned up the strings and played a beautiful melody with the old instrument. And it made all the difference because of the touch of the master's hand. Well, we are from West Tennessee, and we don't have very many violins where we come from. But we do have a lot of fiddles. The problem is the word fiddle doesn't fit, so we thought about it. And the word mandolin fits perfectly. So we're going to sing about the worth of a soul and the old mandolin. Well, it was battered and scarred, and the auctioneer felt it was hardly worth his while to waste much time on the old mandolin, but he held it up with a smile. It sure ain't much, but it's all we got left. I guess we ought to sell it too. Now who's got a bid on this old mandolin? Just one more and we'll be through. And he cried, one, give me $1, who'll make it two? Only $2, who'll make it three? $3 twice, well that's a good price, but who's got a bid for me? Raise up your hand and don't wait any longer, the auction's about to end. Who's got four, just $1 more, to bid on this old mandolin? Well, the air was hot and the people stood around and the sun was setting there. From the back of the crowd, a gray-haired man came forward, pulled up a chair. He wiped the dust from the old mandolin and he tightened up the strings. And he played out a melody pure and sweet, as sweet as the angels sing. And the music stopped, and the auctioneer, with a voice that was quiet and deep, he said, what am I bid for this old mandolin? He held it up for all to see. And he cried out, one, give me 1,000, who'll make it two? Only 2,000, who'll make it three? 3,000 twice, well, that's a good price, but who's got a bid for me? The people cried out, what made the change? We don't understand. And the auctioneer stopped and he said with a smile, it was a touch of the master's hand. Now you know many a man with a life out of tune is battered and scarred with sin, and he's auctioned cheap to a thankless world, much like the old mandolin. And the master comes and the foolish crowd, they never understand the worth of a soul and the change that's wrought by the touch of the master's hand. And he cried out, one, give me 1,000, who'll make it two? Only 2,000, who'll make it three? 3,000 twice, well, that's a good price, but who's got a bid for me? The people cried out, what made the change? We don't understand. And the auctioneer stopped and he said with a smile, it was a touch of the master's hand. It was a touch of the master's hand.
We want to thank Scott for calling us and getting things lined up on this thing. We appreciate that, Scott, very much. We want to thank Dave for being here early with a smile on his face, letting us in and setting things up. We appreciate that, Dave. Thank you. And thank you, folks, for letting us worship with you today. Thank you.
Well, that was fantastic, huh? Yeah. Thank you, Don and Donna, for coming such a long distance to